Big fluff.
Hello, James.
You know, the last person who called me that was the old commander of the Mechanicus Militarium, as he died in my arms.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's all right. I like the way it sounds. It makes me feel something other than hopelessness. You see, I was given memories of a world I will never see. Loyalty to a king I cannot serve, and love for a child I could not save. But the sound of that name, as you said, lets me feel even in the smallest way why I exist at all.
Hey everybody, I'm Joel Murphy.
And I'm Andy McIntyre.
And this is Silver Linings Playback, the podcast where we watch maligned movies and we find their silver linings.
And it is the month of May, one of our favorite months on this podcast. What we know is the revenge of the guest month. Although this time I think we're just punishing our guest further as we watch Rebel Moon 2, The Scargiver with a friend of the show, Erin Fox. Hey Erin, how are you?
Hello, I'm good. I'm confused. I'm looking forward to talking to you both today.
Notice you didn't say about the movie. Just looking forward to talking to us.
Yeah, it's good to see old friends.
always.
All right, well, we were talking about this before we started, and we made a bunch of predictions when we did the last episode, and I think the biggest was from Erin, who did say that you believed that this would completely redeem part one.
I did, and you mentioned that you listened to our predictions, and I didn't think to do that, and I'm sure I made some very silly predictions, and that was certainly at the top of the list.
Well, here if we want a quick sampling, we all made a lot of predictions, and a lot of them were joke predictions, I think it's safe to say. But I think, like just to hit some highlights, Andy predicted a montage of the rebels training people. I think we got that. I think that
we did get that.
Say.
Yeah.
There was some like that seemed easy, but like I don't think really happened. Of like, I predicted that Jenna Malone would be in this in another heavily made up character role. That didn't seem to happen. Andy predicted a surprise actor would be in the movie. I'm not really sure that happened. That anyone that wasn't in the first one that was a surprise.
Does Elvis count? Was he in the first one?
That's okay. Maybe. Yeah. Maybe it's him. I took a big swing on Charlie Hunnam being resurrected.
Someone was resurrected.
You predicted a weird sex scene in slow motion.
That I think that happened, right?
Of course I did.
I think those are the kind of the highlights. But then here's the crazy thing. I actually pulled a segment. The reason I played the clip at the beginning and then I pulled this audio clip for us is I actually think we hit a stretch on here that I'm going to argue was eerily correct. Okay,
so I can't wait to hear. Yeah, did we say?
So this is from the last episode.
Here, that's what I'll predict, though. A weird family connection since, it's Star Wars, that someone will be someone's brother, sister, mother, father.
Well, yeah, because we need the Leia reveal from Jedi. So we need another character to surprise be related to her, I guess.
Yes.
So it's Djimon the robot.
I cannot believe they named that robot and then no one called him that name. It's killing me.
Oh man, what if in the second one they did a like an Obi-Wan bit where it was like, Jimmy the Robot? That's a name I haven't heard in a long time.
So I think we get credit for the three of us together zeroed in on the fact that there would be some sort of tie to Jimmy the Robot that was previously unknown, and that the name, which had not been spoken, would finally be spoken by someone in a sort of Obi-Wan type of way of like, that's a name. And I would say that all of that happened in that scene where she calls him James. And then he says, I haven't heard that name since blah, blah. Like we nailed that.
100%.
Yeah.
I mean, I would say we like TV and movies.
Like they might not have gone to a volcano planet, but they for sure Obi-Wan. Yeah,
no, that definitely hit.
Yeah. So I just love to Andy that you nailed that. It was Jimmy the Robot. Surely joking, but
100% joking,
but it absolutely was. And that makes me happy.
Me too.
So anyway, that catches us up, much like the movie itself. We started with a little recap of the last one.
Yeah.
Which I don't know how you both felt, but for me, it was helpful to be reminded what I watched the last time.
Yeah, I completely forgot every second of that last movie.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, 100%. I'm going to be full disclosure. It's on right now in front of me. Because I can't remember what happened. And I was like, I'm not going to be able to talk about this movie. So I'm watching the end currently. I've watched it 3 times.
You watched it 3 times?
Yeah, I can't tell you what happened. I watched it what I like to refer to as TBS style. I feel like your podcast probably has latchkey kids who are listening to this. And I feel like when I was younger, I would come home and like, a movie would be halfway done on TBS, but then just starts again. So like you watch the end and then like you stay watching TBS and then you watch the beginning of the movie. And then like 3 hours later, they'll play the movie again and you watch it the whole way through. And that's what I've done with this movie.
And that movie was Broken Arrow.
Oh my God. Yeah, it was. Con Air.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. You got to watch Con Air at whatever point.
Yeah, if Connor's on the TV, you keep watching.
Yeah.
But that's what happened with this movie. It was very challenging for me to stay engaged. And I kept looking at my phone. So I watched like the last half first, and then I tried to rewatch it and then got distracted. And then I was like, Fox, you got to button down and watch this movie.
I think you watched it the way it was meant to be watched, though.
Was it meant to be watched? Who knows?
This movie is pure white noise.
Yeah, like, I think, well, okay, so I think we've covered that it doesn't redeem the first one, but do we think it's worse than the first one?
Yes, actually 100% I do.
Okay, like, yeah, I think you're probably right.
I mean, that's fair, but the first one had Jenna Malone.
Right,
this one, yeah. Jenna Malone's not in this movie.
Yeah, the first one had Jenna Malone, and then I think also the first one just had the element of surprise, you know?
Like, there was momentum to it.
Yeah. We didn't know what we were entering into. So yeah,
this movie was
so long.
This movie was the second act of Seven Samurai. And then a really like low, like an inattentive version of Avengers Endgame, where it was just a crazy battle for 45 minutes. And that's the movie.
It also love that the whole first movie and then the beginning of this movie, we were gearing up for obviously Seven Samurai, which like Snyder is open about that. That's not a secret. That's openly what he was trying to do. But then they do that and it's like they train the villagers and we have our team and they do all of it. And then a deus ex machina of a bunch of random people come from the sky and save them.
On your left.
Like, why? Why do so? Because, you know, I haven't seen Seven Samurai in a minute, but if I remember Kurosawa pretty well, I don't think a fleet of spaceships came and saved the samurai.
Or you haven't seen Seven Samurai in a while because that is the third act.
Is that the third act? That's wild. OK.
Yeah. A bunch of superheroes show up.
Yeah.
Crazy explosions. Jimmy the Robot dropping a grenade in a tank.
James. Yeah. His so Christian he's still, name. By the way, never called Jimmy the Robot, just to be clear, as he is credited.
I'm mad about this robot.
Yeah.
But he has deer antlers.
He was more. That was the other thing that Erin, that you were very on to, is that he is very Jesus-y in this movie. Oh, sorry. I didn't give you your biggest prediction that you did absolutely nail, which is that you actually called the fact that the little girl would come back to life.
Good for me.
Yeah.
I'm a genius. I'm a beautiful genius.
Yes. Yeah. So yeah, you absolutely nailed that. And then, yeah, you were very on to like how Jesus-y Jimmy James, the robot, is. And he,
but if there's anything I'm ready to root out, it's a Christian subtext.
But he had a full on crown of thorns, I feel like, in this
movie. I don't know. You just saying Jimmy James, the robot, makes me wonder how much more fun this movie would have been if Stephen Root had voiced the robot instead of Anthony Hopkins.
Or rest in peace, the guy from Varsity Blues who played
Billy Bob.
Billy Bob. Yeah. Who then, I love that, I wish I could remember his name, but that actor is great because he played Billy Bob and then he played the parody of himself in Not Another Teen Movie. Yeah, he played Reggie Ray alongside Avenger Chris Evans. So
that's true.
Yeah, in Chris Evans' best work.
Yeah.
Brunette Chris Evans, right?
Yes. Yep. Yeah, yeah.
Amazing.
Yeah.
Do you ever watch YouTube?
We're on YouTube. We're now on YouTube. So yes, constantly.
There's like one of those, like, I don't remember exactly what it was, like GQ or Wired or whatever, interview with Zack Snyder recently. And, in the first 2 minutes, they ask him how he got, like, how he got to direct, 300, I guess. And he says that he like made this little short film and it was their like proof of concept. And, when they saw it, he like didn't edit it any specific way because he didn't want people to have that in the front of their mind while they were watching it, whatever. Anyway, he said he showed it to the executives and they said, can you do that for 2 hours? Can you make that shot 2 hours long? And I have never heard someone's voice like in my head as much as I heard Zack Snyder be like, yeah, I can make that 2 hours long in this little YouTube video as when I was watching this movie. What a self-aware man.
It's your cousin, Marvin. Marvin Snyder. You know that one shot you've been looking for? Yeah, that's the origin story of all. Like, that explains everything about his career, is that he got that piece of feedback and then never steered away from it.
Yeah, never looked back.
Yeah.
He was like, I can make it as long as you want.
What's
you want 4 hours? Done.
Yeah. What is going on? He's out of like, look, just to reaffirm, if this is your first time listening to all of us discuss a Zack Snyder film, we are pro Zack Snyder on this podcast. We like him as a person, but he's out of control with these director's cuts. I don't know what he's mad with power because of the Snyder cut of Justice League. And he's talking about 4 hour cuts of these films, and I don't understand. Like,
yeah, because that was, this movie needed more.
Yeah, what else does it have to say?
Well, it's also zero chance that Netflix reined him in at all. Like, nothing about this screams.
He didn't get any notes.
No,
like, I don't even think they watched it. Was having it. He like built it into his deal that he would have a director's cut. So I don't, why? Like,
so why the first cut?
Yeah. Yes. Exactly.
Yeah. I also, it does feel like Netflix gave up, right? That I feel like they promoted the first one. They promoted part one and they,
guys, we're not talking about any silver linings. Sorry, Joel.
We'll get there. We'll get to the silver linings. Okay. But I just, doesn't it seem like Netflix gave up? Like, they didn't promote part two. They didn't.
No. I agree.
Yeah. Like, I feel like part one was pretty hyped. Like, I feel like I saw a lot for it. And I feel like this just kind of dropped, you know, just sort of.
Well, because I think they knew the audience was built in, that approximately one third of the people that watched Rebel Moon 1 were going to watch this. No more, no less.
Oh, man.
They made it to us. And that's really all that matters.
They knew we needed a Revenge of the Guest Month episode. So,
yeah, we did. And we got it.
All right. Well, do we, I think we covered the plot, but do we need to cover the plot in more detail?
Like, yeah, could we? Because I don't know what happened.
Oh, man.
Like,
I think what's telling is that as of when we started recording this, there is no plot synopsis on Wikipedia yet.
Oh, yeah, really?
There's no trivia either.
Oh, like, damn.
There's no IMDb trivia either. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is usually our bread and butter on this show. But yeah.
So nobody knows.
Okay. But
she's on the planet and they come back to get the grain, the fascists.
Right.
They get tipped off.
Those guys were fascists?
I would say that's like one of my silver linings is that visual communication there. So they get tipped off that they're coming to get the grain and she trains the villagers and everyone shares their backstory of tragedy, which I also think is a silver lining. Oh, Joel, you didn't like it.
I thought that, like, I like the idea of it, but that dragged, like, that.
Oh, no, 100%. It's a story device that I like, so when it happens, I'm like, oh, great. That thing's happening, but, like.
Do you know what it kind of felt like to me? It almost felt like one of those, like, Golden Girls clip show episodes where they were, like, sitting around, you know, like,
eating cheesecake.
They should have been eating cheesecake because they were just like, do you remember when I had trauma? And then it would, like, flashback to their.
I love that she was like, no, I'm just an orphan. Nothing bad has ever happened to me.
But you know what? I think you set up the plot enough. That's fine for the plot.
That's
yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah. They have the grain. They think that they killed the big bad and that because of that, the ship's going to leave. But because he is still alive, then they're instead going to get the grain and they want to get her. And they train them montage style to fight. And then, yeah, that's about it. But because we were talking about that part. So Cora, the Scargiver, you know, I did listen to a bit of our last episode to try to remember the movie as well. But we kind of talked about that, too, with her, that she was such a like cipher and we didn't really know what was going on. But we get her full backstory in this. And it's wild. I want to know what both of you think about it, because I do think that like I'm sympathetic towards her based on how it happened, but. There's like this idea of like, did she kill the princess or not? And it's like, she did.
100% did.
Yeah. And I thought that was such a big swing of like, it wasn't like she was really forced to. She was definitely like pressured to, but.
But it felt like she had an out.
Yes. Yeah. And so I thought that was. And then there's definitely a tease for a third movie that I do not think will happen. In that the end of this movie is everyone going like, well, I have news for you. You didn't kill the princess because she's not dead. And then old Jimmy the robot's like, well, if she's not dead, we should all go to her and like start living in our utopia. And then the camera pans back as if we're minutes away from part three.
The script is being written as we speak.
I mean, I'm sure it's being written, but is Netflix going to pay for it?
Sure. Why not?
I mean,
so like,
you know, shrinking revenue and like diminishing returns on these.
When does diminishing returns ever stop Netflix? Oh, wait. All the time.
I mean, you get two seasons of a TV show if you're lucky. So two movies is generous.
But that's only 4 hours or 5 hours of content.
So that, I mean,
that's fair.
Yeah, I don't know. I'll, you know what? We'll obviously be back here if it happens, but I'll be surprised. Would this been
better if it were a mini series?
No. Unequivocally, not. No. This didn't need padding. This didn't need filler. This needed to not happen. Probably.
I think it would be better if it was one movie. I think if you took
100%.
Yeah. Sorry. If you took part one and part two and took the best parts of them and did Seven Samurai, it'd be okay.
Oh,
and there's still more. There's still director's cut length stuff happening.
No, we're going in the wrong direction. I think we'll give it 2 hours. I was going to say an hour and 40 minutes, but I'll give Zack Snyder this concession of like a 2 hour cut of these two movies.
215.
Yeah, I'll give him 215.
I'd give it 215, sure. But anything past that, you're really stretching.
Credits included.
You don't need 2.5. Yeah, no,
215 with credits.
Yeah.
212.
So,
yeah.
So like 2 hours of actual movie and then, you know.
Yeah, like a full 120 minutes of runtime of actual content. Yeah.
Yeah.
Might have to do a little bit more Anthony Hopkins voiceover, but that's a good thing to me.
Do you think he did that from his house, right? That's why he did this, right?
He did that into an iPhone.
Yeah. And then they were like, well, it's going to sound metallic anyway. He's a robot, so it's fine. We don't need to clean it up.
He's like tin cans with a string to his friend.
I think we could get Anthony Hopkins to do voiceover for this podcast. Like if we had the money, I get the vibe that he's just in a, I love him so much, but he's at a point in his career where you could just get him for stuff.
Yeah. I think that's accurate. That sounds right. Let's get to work on that.
All right. Let's put together a script.
All right. A-Hop. We got you. Got some ideas for you.
First idea, we're going to stop calling you A-Hop because you probably don't like
that. I'm not. You can
Isn't
stop.
It Sir A-Hop?
Yeah, first A-Hop. Of all, yeah, put some respect on that name.
I will put some respect on A-Hop's name. I will, 100%.
It's
yes.
Sir Hop.
Sir Hop.
Yeah.
Guys, what did you like about this movie?
Are we done maligning it? Are we ready to pivot?
No, okay. We're not done maligning it.
Okay.
We have 4 hours to malign it. I think we pivot at some point and talk about the good stuff.
Were we supposed to silver lining first? Or like,
no, we silver lining second.
Silver line second.
Oh, I've been on this show before.
You're only our second most frequent guest.
Yeah. Oh, I could say a lot more about how bad this movie was. Like, again, Zack Snyder, you're a delightful man. And I like most of your movies, sincerely. Like, I'm not even kidding. I like Sucker Punch. But
which we've watched.
Yeah.
I feel like we have to eventually watch Land of the Dead or just to round out his filmography for the pod.
Well, that's a good, well-liked movie.
What's the one that I think there's one that none of us have seen, right? The
Owls of Ga'Hoole.
Yeah, that's the one. We have to do that one because
Legends of the Guardian.
Yeah. Because that one's a bit because, yeah, I think Dawn of the Dead is pretty respected.
It's pretty well. The two of the Dead movies he did, I think, are pretty well respected.
Yeah.
Too well respected for us to talk about on this podcast.
Yeah, but we could definitely do
Legends of the Guardians, the Owls of Ga'Hoole.
Yeah. That's but by the way, Erin, did
we
you
start doing that now? Probably.
But Erin, did you see in the press tour that he's been doing to lead up to this? I saw that in an interview, Snyder says that Sucker Punch is the only movie that he feels like he really wants to do a director's cut of that. He feels like it's incomplete.
I did. And he has a longer cut. I don't understand, but I'm here. Like I'll watch that movie, even though he burned me twice with these. This movie is full of nothing. I can't explain it because there's very little to explain, if that makes sense.
Well, I think that is part of the reason, too, that this one doesn't stand up as well as the first one, because the first one is introducing a lot. This, like you said, it has the backstories. I think they're kind of done in a clunky way. But then this is just action for 2 hours, which sounds on paper fun, but is not in practice.
Well, I remember a genuine thought I had watching this movie about 40 minutes in. Like I just did like the, you know, press down on my Roku remote to see how much time was left and saw that 40 minutes had elapsed. I'm like, nothing has happened yet.
The movie doesn't start for an hour.
And then it doesn't stop.
Yeah, I think that's I honestly, now that we're talking about, the first half is really slow and drags, and then it's just action. So the pacing is completely like a boomerang. Like it's just lulls you to sleep and then nonstop action.
But it's
go ahead.
As good as his normal action, also. Like that's why I'm also so mad about it. Like it doesn't even look that cool, like all his little slow-mo tricks and stuff. Like, I don't know. He doesn't.
Well, yeah, it's just the narrative nonsense of you have the fascist imperium that is incredibly technologically advanced and then just regular farmers played by Hozier. And that shouldn't work. Like, well,
it had that too of, again, so you're doing Seven Samurai, but it kind of realized the problem with itself in the scene where Djimon Hounsou, who I love,
Hounsou is the best.
Like, he's leading the people, and there's this great battle, and it's very victorious. Like, they have pushed back the fascists, they have taken back the bridge, they've won, and they're all celebrating. And then a giant mechanical, like, tank that was clearly like an AT-AT in the original script, and then like got rewritten. Like,
oh wait, we got to switch this.
Yeah. It got de-Star Wars'd. But anyways, this giant thing that just begins mowing them down, and that's where you go, like, yeah, because this isn't Seven Samurai. These are now just farmers versus like space Nazis, and the space Nazis have way advanced tech.
Yeah, the Lumineers just can't keep up with the fascists, if you're just going to be perfectly honest here.
But it's just, it was like its own premise kind of just fell apart of like, well, why did you ever think? And also, why does Djimon Hounsou not foresee this happening? Like, why do they think, well, they'll just send people, they won't send all of their weapons?
Because they're just a humble farming planet.
But
if you think about logical commitment of resources, they shouldn't have sent all their weapons. That is a colossal waste of time and money. Because Ed Skrein wants to get some revenge.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. How much is this grain, like, priority wise to the, you know, whatever galactic empire, whatever it's called, you know, like, how much is this grain a part of their, like,
it's a rounding error.
Yeah.
Like, that's, I think, probably the thing that I thought of the most, not the grain during the movie, though, was like,
I thought about the grain the whole time.
This movie has all the beats. It has the shape and contours of a story, but divorced from like any meaningful anything, like some grain. Like, that's not a driving force in any, I don't know. It just doesn't, it like does all the stuff a story is supposed to do, but like, I don't care or understand anything that's happening.
Yeah, like, I should be into Kings of Leon fighting back against the fascists, but I'm not.
Yeah, I cry every time I watch V for Vendetta, and I did not find this rousing.
It does. Now that we're talking about it, feels like it should have been something besides grain. Like, if they were growing, like, or maybe not growing, maybe they're mining like crystals that are used in the guns or something, you know, in the laser guns, or
some level of scarcity that actually makes sense for the future, other than flour.
Yeah, they're in the lightsaber, you know, crystal mine or whatever. Like, they're right, mining something that builds like giant weapons for the empire and is hard to get.
And if the empire doesn't get it, that will be a major setback for them, instead of just going to another planet with grain.
See, that's the thing. Like, even if they were the only planet with grain, I would accept that. Like,
yeah. The only planet with the climate to grow rye. Like, sure, that would make sense. And then fighting Mumford and Sons would be logical. Like, it would be a perfectly acceptable thing.
Well, then it's also,
I want you to note, the scene that I'm watching right now, she's wearing a work jacket with patches on her elbows. So every time you make a reference to Mumford and Sons, it's like so visually appropriate for what I'm seeing right now. Sorry, Joel, go on.
Oh, no. Well, I was just going to say, too, like, as we're talking about the planet and the grain, it also seems like a planet of 30 people.
Like, truly.
Yeah.
There's this one tiny village.
Yeah. Is the rest of the planet just empty?
It's filled with grain. Waves of amber grain.
Yeah, just bunches and bunches of grain that the Decemberists have to farm.
The band or the group?
Both. It is both the proto-communist revolt in late 1800s Russia and the Seattle-based indie folk icons, the Decemberists.
Great. Right.
Oh, she's coming out as a bad guy to the village. I bet they're still going to love her.
Oh, this is the end. This is when they're like, no, you're not, because actually she's not dead.
Oh, yeah, they are about to say that.
You can't be arrested for murder if she's not actually dead. Double jeopardy.
They haven't quite got. Yeah. Oh, he's about to reveal.
Yeah.
Still alive. Wow. Yeah. Great.
twist, even though we definitely like saw her die in that flashback, but that's fine. Mm-hmm. But also, I guess they can bring people back.
And then she did the Shawn Michaels, "I'm sorry, I love you" before she got shot.
Yeah. Yeah. Also, I don't know. Like, it does make sense because they're on the sad grain planet. But then it does seem like no one dies except Korra's boyfriend. He's the only person that for real dies. And Charlie Hunnam.
Yeah, he died in the first one.
Yeah. And
did Jenna Malone die or did she skitter off into regroup?
She died.
Died.
Like, yeah. Because she was like she was the mid tier boss, you know, the boss battle. In the first one, but they did take her out. All right. Now, do we want to?
Oh, and then Skrein died at the end.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Which we'll get to that in the silver linings because I liked that. But are we ready to pivot now? Or.
Mm-hmm. There are good things about this movie.
Andy, let's give you, you know what? I'm going to put 60 seconds on the clock. Andy, why don't you get it all out of your system?
Just like. So I liked the scene when Korra disguised herself as a corpse and used that to get revenge and like infiltrate the ship. But then they're like, oh, my God, she's in the ship. Let's do nothing about that. Like that made no sense to me. And then she made them misfire the gun. So it hit the mountains, which isn't going to have any catastrophic effects for that village in a few hours. You know, nonsense.
I also didn't like her meaningful haircuts.
I also, by the way, I liked the plan of like pretending to be injured, but then she just murdered a room full of EMTs trying to save her life.
She did.
Yeah.
They had it coming. I'm just going to say it.
Did they?
Yeah. You know, they have agency. They could have chosen not to fight for the Magisterium. Or whatever they're called.
They should be called the Magisterium.
Yeah, but this movie really suffers from the Zack Snyder thing where he knows the little guy should win and like fighting the power is good, but it is not defined what any of those things are. So it's hard for me to buy in.
He supports the cause, but he doesn't do the reading. That's what you gotta love about Zack Snyder.
Like, he's there to go to the civil rights protest with the girl he's dating, but he did none of the research to know exactly what they're protesting.
He like meant to look it up on Wikipedia, but then he started reading it and got distracted.
So two more things to malign and then we can genuinely pivot. The Beastmaster guy never Beastmastered in this movie.
Yeah, that's true. We did a whole thing with him in the first movie. I forgot about that. But yeah, that doesn't pay off in any way.
Like he should have Beastmastered the hell out of some of those ships in the final fight.
Yeah. No, now that you say it.
He could have had his freedom at any moment.
Yeah. Yeah. The guy who didn't realize, wait, shit, that was it. Oh, man, I could have done that like day one.
And then second, besides Korra and Jimmy the robot, name five characters in this movie, not actors. I submit you can't.
I mean, I Gunner? Called the guy Korra's boyfriend that died. Did you say Gunner? Did you name one?
Gunner? Yeah, that's her capitalist boyfriend.
Okay.
Belisarius. That's the bad guy. Two.
Yep.
That's it.
Aaron's reading the credits.
Everyone else is Djimon, Hounsou, and Skrein. Beastmaster guy, lightsaber woman.
That was a wild story.
Oh, her name is Nemesis.
Oh,
the lightsaber woman.
The lightsaber woman's name is Nemesis.
She's great. Okay. If we're ready to She's pivot, awesome. We can.
Yeah, that scene was dope.
Yeah. Are we? Shall we?
Yeah, let's
Djimon Hounsou is named Titus.
Sure.
Blood Axe was someone's name, guys. Okay.
Blood Axe was played by Cyborg, I think. And then, yeah, but he died in the first one. Then his sister showed up with all the spaceships at the end.
Wow. Don't know any of these people's names. Great.
Yeah. All right. But yeah, what did we say? I already forgot the name that you told me a minute ago, but the lightsaber woman.
Nemesis.
That scene with her and the lightsaber, I think, was my favorite. Battle.
That scene was dope. Yeah.
Yeah.
In the barn.
Yeah. And when the little kid like came and like stabbed the guy. It's good Zack Snyder stuff.
Yeah, I was definitely down for that.
Yeah. And then I hinted at it, but look, I mean, everything else about this movie aside, when Korra cut the villain's head off at the end. I did enjoy that. Like that
after smushing him in the door. That was great.
Yeah. Like completely trapped him halfway in and out of the door and then just lopped his head off with the sword.
And it was Chekhov's beheading because she mentioned beheading him earlier in the movie.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. All of that was good. I thought that was a well executed scene. I liked the save by her boyfriend, coming in, you know, when all hope seemed lost. That was a good sequence. It was a good fight. I even liked the they're falling from the sky slanted battle shenanigans. Yeah,
that was the stuff on the spaceship or the airship, whatever you want to call it, when she invades. I thought that was all pretty fun and interesting. And her just murdering a bunch of innocents.
I think the best writing of tension for me too was when they have the standoff, when they're about to have the battle and she walks out and she confronts the guy. And he kind of throws a monkey wrench in all of it and goes, I'll tell you what, I'll spare everyone else if you surrender right now and I take you back as my prisoner. I thought those were good stakes. I thought that was a really good move. And then I like that she was willing to do it, which also feels like the right move. And then the decision was taken away from her where her boyfriend fires the signal and starts the battle. That was good. That was good stuff.
Yep.
Like, I feel like
and it saves us the part three of them going to rescue her, which also objectively good.
Yes. I feel like her characterization overall was very consistent, which I liked. She pulled the trigger when he gave her the option to kill her when she was a child. And then she killed that child and then she killed all those people. I like that she had but she had that integrity that she wasn't going to let everyone die on her behalf. So I appreciated that, she had a consistent characterization and at least the decisions and actions that she made and took did seem logical and in alignment with her characterization, even if the story itself didn't make too much sense.
Yeah, I feel like she made more sense in this movie. I understood the character more this time. Yeah.
Well, and I like that scene where Belisarius is clearly staging a coup, but then she kills the childlike empress. And Belisarius immediately is she's the one staging the revolt. Kill her. Kill her. It was just a great flip of the tenet of fascism of, don't believe what you see type of thing. When the people were there to witness that she was not the guilty party and stuff. So I thought that was well done.
But also
is Belisarius the guy that she scarred?
No, that's not Belisarius. That's, I don't know, Ed Skrein.
But then also, did she escape via editing? Did we see her get out of that room?
Yes. She escaped via editing.
Okay, that's what I thought.
She rode a submarine several miles.
Because that was I agree with you that scene was good, but it is, she's in a room full of people who are now agreeing that she is the sole murderer, and then we just cut back. And it's but you got out of there. You're here now. So we skip some steps. But yeah, the scar.
That's going to be in the director's cut.
Yeah, yeah, I hope so. Oh, man. What else is in the director's cut? I wonder.
Oh, my God.
A lot more farming.
Oh,
slow motion farming.
Yes.
You know what? I'm not even kidding. That was a silver lining for me. The I felt like I was watching a really great classic Super Bowl commercial, but those shots of people harvesting grain are some of the finest shots of people harvesting grain I've ever seen in my entire life. They're beautiful. The color grading was A+. They looked great.
Zack, felt the amber in those waves of grain.
Yeah, Zack, if you're listening, the best grain shots I've seen.
You should
do
a Budweiser commercial next Super Bowl.
He should. If you put all you would need, I'm telling you, you take those shots and then you cut to some Clydesdales, and that is a Super Bowl commercial. You've already done it.
It is 100%.
Who that guy Ed Skrein? Is that his name?
That's the guy that got the scar. Yeah,
he was a silver lining for me.
I like him. Yeah.
He really was all gas, no brakes with his performance. And I respect it.
I know. I thought he was great too. I was trying to remember. I couldn't remember enough of what he was like in the first movie to I was trying to make sense of if he was changed by dying, if that made him harsher or like go harder. And I really couldn't, or maybe crazier, but I couldn't tell. But I thought maybe. But either way, I liked him in this
one. I think more willing to accept losses in order to get revenge was the big shift.
Yeah. I think he was really mad. Like, I don't know that it had to do with him dying and coming back like weird or like tweaked a little bit. He was more unhinged, but I think it's because he was defeated. Yeah. And he was like, I have to like correct this wrong.
And then what was up with it? He had his bro that like seemed down, like the guy that brought him back. That was just like, yeah, like because everyone else on the ship seemed a little questioning it. And then his like lieutenant was just like, yeah, it's cool. It's fine. I'm down. Down for the cause.
You gotta be an enabler.
Yeah. All right.
Yeah. So he did a good job acting. Or like, I don't know if he did a good job acting. I was entertained and I respected what he was doing.
He gave the right performance for the movie he was in.
Yeah. Yeah. That was good. I liked that.
Because yeah, it's just, I mean, I know we're done maligning it, but Sophie Boutella, who plays Cora, best plays like taciturn, like heavies, for lack of a better word. Not the best choice for the emotional center of the movie because she's sort of expressionless.
She's an excellent action hero.
Oh, a great action hero. Yeah,
I feel like you don't always need to plumb emotional depths to do that.
Well, she's also a great Zack Snyder protagonist in that she has a really interesting look that he films, you know, memorably. So like she looks cool in the movie at all times.
Yeah, no, she looks cool as hell.
Yeah.
Like all her different haircuts and.
You mentioned him, always a silver lining to see. And I'm never sure if it's Cary Elwes or Cary Elwes, however we say it. But, you know,
it's Elwes, I think.
But always delightful.
Always excited to see Cary Elwes.
Yeah, yeah.
Looking a lot like Jack Black in this one.
Yeah. Older. Like
big gray beard.
I love the beard. Yeah. It took me a second to recognize him. I don't know if you both like clocked him right away, but I definitely like took
it's the eyes.
Yeah. Also, when he started talking, you know, it was clear, but
I didn't remember if he had any lines. I'm going to be perfectly honest.
I don't think he did. I just watched it.
I think he said something. He was like, oh, don't shoot us. Sorry, something.
That's right.
He had a line.
It's like, hey, I don't like getting shot at.
But what he really meant was, I love you.
As you wish.
Yeah.
Unlike other Magisterium kings, I have a British accent.
Oh, man.
Like, also, why were they fighting that Imperial force? Like, I wish I knew more about, like, why there was conflict, almost. I feel like I would care more. I don't know. Obviously,
they wanted more grain than they had to give.
I do think there's a problem, and that kind of plays into the end of just, like, I don't even know if I really understood that there was, like, a whole rebel faction. I don't think the actual world makes sense unless you just go, like, well, it's Star Wars. So then I understand how Star Wars worked, but...
Well, yeah. And that's the thing, is they weren't rebelling. They were defending their turf.
Okay.
They weren't trying to overthrow like the Imperium or whatever. They were.
That's a
like,
good point.
Like they were just defending territory that they felt they were owed. Which makes sense. Like they weren't setting out to overthrow Belisarius or whatever. Donald Belisario.
Well, and
from
what I remember, the first one, part of the deal was that he just showed up and was like, well, we have a contract for this much grain, but we want it all, was basically.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Which, again, yeah. So that's on them. I don't. Yeah. But I just didn't understand who the people were exactly at the end who showed up. But like in terms of, I don't know, the bigger picture of everything.
They were the people that like the Blood Axes actually were staging a rebellion. And so they thought this was a good time to strike because Gautier was defeating the Imperium or whatever. So they're like, oh, we can capitalize on this.
All right. Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Like compelling.
I think I might have just put more thought into it than Zack Snyder did.
But yeah, big ups.
Best case scenario, it's a mid reason.
I also, again, you give it more thought because I was just like, well, it's Star Wars. They're just doing Star Wars.
They're just Star Warsing. Yes.
Yeah, it's hard to not see that it's Star Wars.
Yeah.
It's like,
does anybody not see that it's Star Wars in the universe?
But that, I mean, like watching it and like being like, oh, this is a movie I will enjoy, and just not seeing that it's supposed to be Star Wars is impossible. And I'm distracted because I know what's going on in Star Wars. Like overall, I don't know this new place or who these people are. Like, I can't be bothered with this movie. I'm so sad. Guys, I really wanted to like it.
I did find
you put the work in for sure.
I mean, you watched it 3 times, which you alone are propping up its streaming numbers. I think.
I'll be honest, 3 more times than I watched it.
The sad part is, if I'm being honest, I think it took me about 3 sittings to finish it. Like, because I started it and I need a little break. I'm gonna
You're just like, oh, what happened? I stopped paying attention. I have to rewind it.
Yeah. I had to come back.
I was doing the Sunday crossword for a good chunk of this movie. I'll be perfectly honest.
It's too bad. Could have been great. I don't know. Could it have been? Maybe not.
I do.
Can anything this derivative be great?
Yeah, fair.
I mean, you said Robin Hood Men in Tights. You referenced that. That's pretty
good. Magnificent Seven was great. And that is almost shot for shot remake of Seven Samurai. So, I take that back.
Look, there's a lot of American Westerns that just were like, what if we did Kurosawa? So, I mean, that's tried and true. But that's it. Is that it's when you do space Kurosawa, you know, it's like two things. It's too far. I don't know. Because I don't know.
George Lucas did it. Hidden Fortress, and there's an episode of Mandalorian that's just Seven Samurai.
But I guess that's it. But that's already Star Wars, so it's you're both derivative of Kurosawa and Star Wars. I think so. You're derivative
like a copy of a copy.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's just I don't know. Yeah, I don't know. I found the swords interesting. I like that their laser swords just become regular swords. That's interesting.
What grade would you give it?
Overall.
Yeah. No, just this movie. Okay, just this movie, and then both movies together as a franchise.
Okay. Am I going first?
Yep, you're going first.
Whoever has an idea.
I'll go stars. I don't know grades, so I'll give stars like out of 5. So I'll give this one like 2.
So 40. D. Yeah.
Yeah.
A D. Okay.
Yeah. I forgot I had a teacher here. So yeah.
I would agree.
And I'd probably give the first one like 2.5.
Well, then this thing is like, it's not a failure, but it doesn't succeed. So I think a D is an apt grade for this movie.
Yeah.
It's like a movie. Like it's a professionally made.
And it looks great.
Movie.
Like it's made effectively.
We didn't say that for a silver lining, but the special effects are phenomenal. Like all the VFX work in this is top notch. Like I thought everything looked great.
No, and there's a really good blending of conventional sets and green screen and stuff. Like I think they actually like built some of the sets for the spaceship. The barn, I think, was completely CG, but you know.
The grain was fake. There's no way.
That was all fake. Grain. That's not real grain.
Look too good. Real grain don't look that good. That's fake grain.
AI grain.
See, here's the fun fact is that this movie is actually imitating life because Zack Snyder raided a small farm to steal all their grain to feed use it for the movie. And so this is just art imitating life, imitating art.
I don't believe that. He's too good of a dude. I don't think he did.
That's true. As soon as I said that, I was like, that'd be funny if he sucked, but he doesn't suck.
He would buy some grain.
Like that's some Joss Whedon shit. That's not Zack Snyder stuff.
Oh, look, it's 100% true that Joss Whedon has raided a small town to take all their grain.
Yeah, that's for sure happened.
That happened for like a spec script of Firefly that they didn't even shoot. He was just like, get us the grain. And then they came back and they're like, oh, you got that grain. And he was like, what now?
Show's canceled. Sorry.
All right. But no one else went. I gave my grades and then nobody else.
Give it a D and I would
give it a D. Like,
you gave the second one also a D. You gave it a 50.
I give it a slightly higher. Yeah. It gets an extra half from me.
Together. Is it slightly higher or just each part separately?
I'd say together. I'd say the first half carries the second half a little bit more. So they can. What is it if I give it 2.5 for overall?
So were you any less lost having seen the first half watching this one? Or do you think you could have watched this cold and been fine?
I don't think lost is the right word, but I think you'd be more detached. And I know that I'm saying that as someone that I don't think I was terribly invested, but I at least felt like I knew who everyone was in a way that if you just were launched into this one, I think you wouldn't, you'd be like, why do I care about these people? And I think you at least like you had spent time with them, so they felt familiar. And I think that helped.
I'll give you that.
Yeah.
D plus.
Okay. D plus. Erin?
Just a D. Just like a 64 or whatever.
Sure.
Yeah.
I like that. I can go with that.
All right. Yeah.
And we did it.
Yeah. And it definitely, I think we said this with the last one, but I think it's...
Talks more about this movie than anyone in the world.
But yeah, I do think it's like bottom of the Snyder that I've seen, I think.
Yeah.
But we haven't seen that
album. Any of his movies are good.
What's that?
Do you think any of his movies are good?
Sure. Yeah. No, I think
I genuinely like 300. I like Sucker Punch. Dawn of the Dead, I think it was a little better than Land of the Dead. I don't hate The Watchmen. I think he misses the point wildly, but I don't hate it. The Superman movies I don't like, but
I agree.
But yeah.
Yeah.
I'll go with
this
that.
This is not a good one.
I'd agree with those takes. I think I also said that when we did Justice League, I do think his cut is better than Whedon's.
I'd agree with that.
Who was that? Did you see that, by the way, too, Erin? I just want to bring up things that I read. I saw another little tidbit that he said that it was DiCaprio. He met with DiCaprio about being in, I think it was Batman versus Superman. Mm-hmm. And DiCaprio was the one who gave him the idea that Superman should fight the Justice League. And he was like, oh, that's really cool. You know, I hadn't thought of that. And then, of course, DiCaprio was like, but I'm not going to, like, he didn't do it.
I'm not doing this movie.
But he was the one who gave him the idea. So that's why that happened, because of Leonardo DiCaprio. So,
wow, the impact.
Yeah. I hope he never stops doing interviews. That's a silver lining, is Zack Snyder should continue to talk forever.
Yeah, he's dressed like a hobbit in the one that I watched. He's like a waistcoat. He looks great. He's doing great.
He's,
I love Zack Snyder.
No, he's amazing. No, he's such a great person. And no, he makes me so endlessly happy. And I love discussing him as a person.
I like wish this movie was worse so we would have more than talk about, but it was just such a poof of air. Of a movie. Sorry.
It is a cipher of a movie for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. It's just, it's nothing. Yeah. We talked way too long about a movie that is just as I think you summed it up, Erin, when you said it's a copy of a copy of a movie. Like it's just,
hard to have takes.
I understand why Lucasfilms passed.
Yeah.
But not me. I watched it 3 times.
Did it start again? Are you going to be on number 4? No,
I'm going to watch it again though. Cause my brain is like, what happened to this movie? Probably watch it one more time and then I'll give up. But
bless you, Erin Fox.
Got to help him put up those numbers.
All right. Well, before we go, is there anything that you would like to point people towards?
Yeah. If you're listening to this in the month of May, you could donate your money to the Baltimore Abortion Fund for Fundathon. People need healthcare and it's getting harder for them to get. So you can help them out with a donation.
Please do.
Yeah. And thank you so much for doing this. It's always great to see you. And that is always a silver lining.
Oh, yeah. Maybe we'll watch a good movie next time.
Nope, we're watching Owls of Ga'Hoole.
Oh man. Do the owls, are they also like a metaphor for capitalism?
They're the little guys.
They are.
Maybe.
Who's the oppressive force? I need to know more about these owls.
Save it for the next episode.
Only one way to find out, exactly.
Tune in next week when we talk about the Owls of Ga'Hoole.
Silver Linings Playback is a production of HoboTrashCan.com. If you enjoyed the show, please rate or review it on Apple Podcasts. Hear more great shows on the Peak Sloth Podcast Network.